Greetings. Vijñāna-bhairava-tantra, verse 52. Now we're at a transition point in the text. We leave behind for the moment the spaciousness practices, and we encounter some traditional tantric yoga practices. And then, curiously, the text returns to spaciousness practices for a few verses before getting into a substantial section on bliss practices. So verse 52 introduces the traditional tantric yoga practice of deha-śuddhi. Now, when I say traditional, there are several ways to use this word, because of course, everything in the Vijñāna-bhairava tantra is traditional, comes to us from tradition, from lineage, and so on. But also, it's important to remember that the Vijñāna-bhairava tantra is an atypical tantra. It's an atypical scripture within the tantric tradition. So usually, tantras are much, much, much longer than the VBT, running even to thousands of verses instead of 150. And mostly, tantras will present a comprehensive overview and often in-depth exploration of the four primary topics of the tantric tradition, which are jnana, which means wisdom or knowledge or doctrine, yoga, broadly construed, usually referring to energy body practices, meditative practices, awareness cultivation, kriya, meaning ritual in this context, and charya, meaning daily life, observances, and periodic vows. So those are the four main topics that we find in the tantras, and every tantra covers those four topics, some more than others, you know, depends on the tantra. But again, the VBT is atypical in terms of the tantras that have come down to us. So in that sense, we could say that some of the practices it presents are also atypical, meaning to say the VBT presents many practices that are only found here or only found in a very small handful of scriptures. So we can distinguish within the text those practices that are innovations and those that are part of the pan-tantric tradition. So that's what I mean when I say that deha-śuddhi is a traditional practice, meaning to say it's a practice found in all the tantras, unlike some of the other VBT practices. So more on that later. So deha-śuddhi has already been taught in a video in the Tantric Yoga Now group, and so we'll just go over the VBT version of deha-śuddhi. So the verse goes like this. Kāla-gninā kāla-padād utthitena svakaṃ puram pluṣṭaṃ vicintayed ante śāntābhāsas tadā bhavet. One may imagine that one's own body is incinerated by the fire of time rising from the foot of time. At the end of this process, there is the radiant shining of pure tranquility. Okay, so to understand this verse, we have to understand the foundational tantric teaching that the body is a microcosm of the whole universe. And for that, we need to then look at a little bit about cosmology. So in medieval Indian tradition, not only tantric, but Puranic as well, the universe was conceived of as, metaphorically, as a kind of giant egg within which there are many, many, many dimensions and sort of planes of existence. So according to Shaiva tantric sources, there are 118 dimensions or planes of existence, of which this earth plane is only one, and these dimensions can overlap and coexist at different kind of levels of vibration, and they can also not overlap as well. So it's a fairly complex cosmology, which is again metaphorically described as Brahmanda, the egg of Brahman, or the egg of Brahma. So this kind of image is found in many, many sources. And in terms of this conceptualization of all the different levels of reality, it's conceptualized that there's a flame at the base of this egg of Brahma. Now, we don't know to what extent were people taking this literally. I mean, certainly some people were. Some authors of Puranas were certainly taking this more or less literally, that there are these many, many, many dimensions of reality arranged in this particular way, and that there is this kālāgninā, this fire of time, which is sort of like a pilot light at the base of the egg of Brahma. And when it's time for the universe to be destroyed, that flame, that kālāgninā, fire of time, blazes up and consumes the entire universe and dissolves the entire universe. Or we could even say multiverse, if we like, because again, in this conceptualization of the universe, there are dimensions of reality that are non-overlapping. So at any rate, whether we take it metaphorically or literally doesn't matter for the practice, right? Tantric yoga practices are effective without any kind of need to subscribe to the cosmology that the tradition discusses in any literal sense. But anyway, the point here is that just there's this fire of time that can blaze up and consume the whole universe, and therefore, in this practice, the whole body is devoured by this fire of time. And this is, again, a key and foundational tantric practice in which, according to Abhinavagupta, what is really consumed in this fire, this kālāgninā, this fire of time, what's consumed is the socially constructed self, the socio-culturally constructed self is offered into this fire. So it's quite a deep teaching that, you know, the tradition is very, very diverse. And of course, many, many people were doing this practice in a kind of routinized or ritualized way without having these deeper teachings about what the practice actually signifies. But certainly in the Kaulatrika lineage, there were these teachings on the deeper significance of the practice. And even though sometimes they sound quite modern in their articulation, right, the deconstruction or burning away of the socio-culturally constructed self seems like quite a modern concept, but indeed it is taught in just those terms within the lineage itself 1,000 years ago. So in the practice then, one is to, when one imagines the fire rising through the body, and I'll describe it in a little more detail in a moment, one is offering into that fire all of one's self-images, body image especially, but not just body image, the whole socially constructed self, Abhinavagupta teaches us, is to be offered into this fire. That is to say, your conceptions about yourself that come from social conditioning, sociocultural conditioning, all should be offered into this fire. And just as the fire of time will dissolve and destroy the entire universe, so the universe of limited individuality, of separate selfhood, is to be destroyed, dissolved in this fire on a daily basis, because traditionally this would be a practice that most tantrikas would do every day. And it's a practice you can do in just a few minutes, and it's a powerful way to remind yourself that you are not your story about yourself. You are not this socio-culturally constructed personality, right? And there's nothing wrong with having a socioculturally constructed personality. It's about becoming free of the belief that that is oneself. Okay. So then it becomes rather the role that one plays as in a drama, right? That the actor never believes that he or she is the character they're portraying, and yet they still try to portray their character to the best of their ability. And in the same way, and this is an actual teaching in the tradition, we are invited to portray our character to the best of our ability without ever believing that we are our character. So this practice, in a sense, is burning away little by little every day the belief that you are your character, until you start to experience yourself as the one divine actor who plays and portrays all the characters, right? The radiant no-thingness that takes on form and dances in the various roles that it has to play. And not just shifting metaphors a little bit there, not randomly though, because in the tradition itself, the metaphor of actor and dancer are used interchangeably in this context. So in the practice itself, what do you actually do? Well, let's look at the verse again. So kālāgninā, by the fire of time, right? And this is actually significant, not only because it's naming this specific fire that will destroy the whole universe when it's time for the universe to dissolve, but also that the fire of time burns away time itself. So this is another layer to the practice, that we're actually that the autobiographical notion of self, meaning your story of yourself, is a story that exists within the context of the conception of linear time, right? So this autobiographical self that you have is built largely out of memories and other forms of conditioning, right? Your self images are based on and contingent on memories, both emotional memories in the body as well as mental memories, right? So we're invited through our spiritual practice to learn how to access a place of pure timelessness, a place outside — it's not a place, of course, that's just a metaphorical use of the term — outside this conception of linear time, right? Which some interesting kind of explorations and discoveries in modern physics also imply that linear time is actually a mental construct. It's a specific way that human consciousness has of perceiving reality, that's not necessarily intrinsic to reality itself. So the fire of time burns away the autobiographical self also by releasing us from the bondage of experiencing ourselves within linear time and dependent upon our past, right? So everyone who has cultivated a deep meditation practice has experienced this total timelessness, even if just for a few moments. Those moments are timeless moments, right? They don't feel like moments. They feel like an immersion into pure timeless being itself. Okay, so then we have the phrase, back to the verse, kāla-padād, from the foot of time. An odd phrase, and indeed the commentator just glosses it as from the right foot, that the pilot light, as it were, that starts the fire that consumes the whole body, is in the toe, the big toe of the right foot. Why does the original text use this strange and atypical phrase, the foot of time? Probably just to, again, connect it to that notion of a tiny flame which can blaze up and consume the whole. Okay, so we get the verb in the second half of the verse, vicintayed, one may imagine that one's body, svakaṃ puram, or one's fortress, And this is a word for body, which is an interesting choice here, right? Because the pura can mean body, but it can also mean fortress. And indeed, there is a way in which this sense of separate selfhood, limited individuality, walls us off from our natural state of oneness with the whole, right? So body image as a kind of fortress or kind of image of ourselves behind which we can hide, as it were. This is to be burned away, right? So one should imagine one's own body fortress as pluṣṭaṃ, as incinerated, as scorched, burned away by the fire of time that is rising from the foot. And in the end, at the terminus of this practice, one may experience śāntābhāsa, the radiant shining of pure peacefulness, or the radiant shining of pure tranquility, right? Śānta, of course, related to the word śānti, peace. So śānta means peaceful, and ābhāsa means radiant shining, but also in the tantric tradition means a particular way that consciousness can shine forth. So actually everything is an ābhāsa, a way that consciousness shines. Like if you, whatever, pick up a rock and hold a rock and experience its rockiness, that's consciousness shining forth in the form of rock. It's an ābhāsa. There's a lot more to that doctrine, which is explained in Tantra Illuminated. But here we have the shining forth of our natural capacity for pure, tranquil peacefulness. So it's important here to realize that this is not a peacefulness we need to attain, that it's actually our natural state, and it's revealed naturally when body image and socially constructed self is burned away, even for just a moment. Okay. So in the traditional practice, there are, as often in tantric yoga, there are several elements that are entrained, that are synced up in the practice. So those elements are visualization, mantra, and mudra. But for now, we're just going to keep it simple and learn the visualization and the mudra. And in the other video already posted in Tantric Yoga Now group, I also give the mantra, right? So there's three elements that come together that are entrained in this practice. But for now, in this public video, we'll just learn two of them. Okay, so what you imagine is this incandescent white flame, white hot flame in the tip of your big toe of the right foot. Now, Swami Lakshmanju says left foot for whatever reason, even though our Sanskrit commentaries clearly say right foot. I don't think it actually matters. I actually do the practice starting from the tips of both big toes. So, but the point is that this little white flame is inside the body. It's inside the tip of the big toe, or both big toes. And as it starts to rise through the body, one does a mudra, which is called Mahamudra, a bit confusingly because there's a number of mudras that are called Mahamudra, right? And when it comes to naming and labeling things in the tradition, we don't find consistency at all. The same practice will be named something different in two different lineages, and different practices will have the same name. So in terms of naming and labeling, it's not consistent. We don't need to worry about that too much. We don't need to get attached to our labels, right? But one practice taught under the name Mahamudra is the mudra that's relevant to this practice is where let's see if I can adjust the video a little bit where you can't see the whole of me, but you bring the hands Sorry for the awkward informality of this. So the hands start over the big toes of both feet and they rise with the fire. So the hands start crossed only if the feet are crossed. So if you're sitting in a chair or if your feet are, your legs are not crossed, then the hands won't be crossed, right? So my hands are crossed, my arms are crossed because my legs are. So the middle of the palms of both hands is hovering over the tips of both big toes as I vividly imagine the white hot incandescent flame rising through the body. I'm tracking its rise with the hands. Until the hands come all the way up, up, up to here, right? And this is again called Mahamudra, even though there's many other things that are also called Mahamudra. And you sometimes actually see in pujas in modern India, people doing a very, very quick version of this practice, or priests, just they'll go like this and move their hands rapidly over the body, which is indeed a holdover, as it were, from this practice of tantric yoga. So in the ritualized form of it, they're usually not taking the time to really fully imagine it and feel it. They're just doing the movement and doing the mantra. So this is what happens oftentimes in Indian tradition and in all religious traditions, is that practices get routinized and reduced to ritual forms. But what makes it tantric yoga, of course, as opposed to just ritual, is that you're actually seeking to feel something here. You're actually seeking to really offer your self-images into this incandescent fire. Okay, so I'll sing the verse again, and then let's do the practice. So somebody mentions in the comments here, burning away all that you are not. And see, this is interesting actually, because we're invited in this practice to throw everything into the fire, everything that we think we are, because as one of my teachers says, nothing false will survive and nothing true will perish. That the truth cannot be burned, right? The truth cannot be destroyed. So you just throw everything into the fire, including whatever you think is even your very heart and soul, because most of us, you know, what we consider our soul is actually just a subtler layer of self-image. So as one of my teachers suggests, if you just throw everything into the fire, you're good, because nothing true will perish and nothing false will survive. So everything that you think you are gets offered into the fire, because what you truly are cannot be created or destroyed. It is unborn and undying, pure being, presence. So let's explore that and encounter that if we can in this moment. So taking a upright posture, relaxed but upright posture. And taking a few deep breaths. Letting the eyes close and feeling your whole body, letting yourself realize that even if you're not thinking about your self-images or your body image, they're there under the surface of conscious awareness, and that your body image influences how you experience your embodiment. Now resolve to offer this body image and all your self images into this fire. And then bring your awareness to the tips of both big toes. Imagining or feeling, if you can, that there is an incandescent, white, hot, tiny flame inside the big toes of both feet. First the right and then the left. And this flame starts spreading. Spreading through the feet, the ankles. And if you like, you can track the rise of this flame with the mudra, open palms, open hands, because you're not holding on to anything. You're releasing everything into this fire. Feeling or even just imagining that the incandescent white hot fire is rising through the body. Rising through the legs. Now the whole pelvic area catches fire. Rising through the torso. Flames licking up the back. The fire is now inside and outside the body. The whole body is becoming enveloped in flames. Rising through the upper torso, the arms, the head, until everything, the whole body and subtle body, everything is aflame with this white hot incandescent fire. Offer into this fire now. Everything that you think you are, all your self-images, all your ideas about yourself. You might let a few of those ideas arise as verbal thoughts. I am such and such a kind of person. Whatever arises, I'm not good enough. Offer that into the fire. I'm a good person. I'm a kind person. Offer that into the fire. Anything that you think you are, just offer it into the fire, along with your body image. Let it all burn. All so-called positive self-images, as well as so-called negative self-images, let them all burn now. And the flame blazes brighter and brighter, consuming everything. It blazes so bright and hot that as it dies down, it leaves behind nothing whatsoever. Just a thin layer of ash on the ground, where once there was a body and a separate self. And enter into pure, transparent being now. Just become the pure, open transparency that you actually are. It doesn't matter if there's thoughts or feelings. They're just vibrations of energy within the pure, open transparency that you are. And then let the pure transparency thicken into form as a physical body. But now, experiencing the physical body as a direct expression of that pure transparency. Experiencing the body as nothing but consciousness made flesh. You don't need to regard it as a contraction or a stepping down. You can experience it as a pure, direct expression of transparent, open awareness. We'll conclude the practice by gazing at the body with fresh eyes. Allow your spine to curve a bit, allow the chin to drop towards the chest. And when you're ready, open your eyes halfway and take in the vision of your own body as a direct expression of pure, transparent awareness. For a moment at least, see the body without all your ideas about it. and also regard yourself without all your ideas about yourself. Imagine in this moment you had no memories at all. Who or what are you without reference to memory or self-concept? That's a question that has no answer in words. You feel the answer. Who or what am I without reference to memory or self-concept? What is my body minus all my ideas about it? What's it feel like to bring your hands together without any ideas about what it means? Om. So that's the practice of deha-śuddhi. Wow, time flies. That video felt much shorter than it is. So just, even though the video is already over long, we'll just take a moment for a little Q&A. Wendy asks, how to live a spiritual life with teenagers around? This time, my oldest son, who's a hardcore atheist, passes by and sees the video. And he just shakes his head and sighs, indoctrination. Isn't that ironic, right? Because in this particular practice anyway, exactly what we're seeking to do is release all our ideas about ourselves. Release all our ideas about even what we're doing here. Let it all burn, right? So I'll do a video hopefully next week on this topic of obstacles to the path, such as family and work and challenging relationships. And I want to invite you into the contemplation that actually the seeming obstacles to the path are the path. So this question of like how to live a spiritual life with teenagers around or whatever you perceive your challenges being, that in this tantric way, that's exactly, that is the path, actually. There are the what seems like the obstacles to the path are the path itself, right? So there's no problem, there's no impediment to living a spiritual life in the midst of whatever you regard as antithetical to the spiritual life. That's just a mental construct, another construct to be offered into the fire, right? It's totally fine. It's in fact wonderful for the people around you to think whatever they think about your practice. Why would that matter to you? It only matters if you've got an image of practice and an image of yourself as spiritual that has yet to be burned, right? When you're truly burning all the self images, then it's not only okay when others ridicule you or your practice, it's wonderful. It's absolutely wonderful that they're having the experience of consciousness that they're having, and you wouldn't have it any other way, right? Om. See you next time.